Taka Nakagami just absolutely obliterated the first sector. Now, that should not be of a great shock, because the 30-year-old Japanese rider, who has retained his seat at LCR Honda next year, despite all the rumours about Ayagura potentially moving up from Moto2 to replace him, he's a bit of an Aragon specialist, Simon, although fluffed his lines big time from pole here a couple of years ago, didn't he? Didn't even make it round past the first sector, and that was a big waste opportunity for this man.
Yep, and I don't know what to say, but I thought of exactly the same thing when he was going fast this morning. But to be fair, Tucker's fast here, so let's see what he can do.
At the moment, he's on course to take the top time of the day so far here in Aragon. 1:47.842 is the benchmark time we're all looking at. You can see it in the top left-hand corner of your screen, set by Vinales on the factory Aprilia. Nakagami at the moment estimated to climb up five spots from seventh to second. His Honda just creeps towards 340 kilometers an hour down the end of that near 1,000 meter back straight. Now, through the final corner he goes. He'll pick the bike up now on the fat part of the tyre, drive towards the finish line. Nakagami moves up to fifth with a 1:47.911.
Something I'll be thinking about, Matt, is see the left-handers, you have temperature. Most of the guys are on the hard front. All on the soft rear, but majority on the hard front. So what I think they'll be doing is being careful on the right-hand side, because you'd be really aggressive everywhere else, but these from turn 1 to turn 2 and turn 12 to turn 13, you've got to be careful that front temperature is there before you throw it on the side. You've got to be a little bit cautious.
Just stay quiet there, just briefly, just to hear that factory Ducati sink towards top gear and 350 odd kilometers an hour in the hands of Pekka Bagnaia. Now then, through turn 17, the Italian comes. Now this may well be good enough to put him top of this second practice session here. Alex Rinzach on the factory Suzuki has gone top with a 1:47.665. He was directly behind Bagnaia, picking up some perfect slipstream there on the GSX-RR. And Rins then, born and bred, wasn't he, just a short distance away from this Aragon circuit. He'll have a lot of support from his family and friends here this weekend. He now leads with a 1:47.665. It's going to chop and change here. Late drama coming in the final 3 minutes of this second practice session here in Aragon. Jorge Martin then, he comes through the final corner. Look at the time that Martin's got in his pocket. What about Fabio Quartararo as well? There is the world champion out of the final corner. Here comes Quartararo, does indeed go top. A brilliant 1:47.476 from him. He's immediately bettered though by Martin. He gets down to a 1:47.402. 700s then between Martin and Quartararo at the top of the timesheets. Vinales though trying to respond here. Another good lap being put in by Rins as well. We're right on board though with Vinales over the line. No, he loses time in that fourth sector. He stays in P5.
Super hard to stop it for turn one there. It's so tight, Matt. You'd normally see guys heading off straight ahead there.
Alex Rins then. In fact, Rins' his last lap was cancelled, I'm guessing, for exceeding the track limits as he tried to keep tabs with Bagnaia. Back with, though, the number 42. Six races for the factory Suzuki team to try and recover their early season glories, really. I mean, let's not forget this man was the joint world championship leader after round five in Portimao. Then the wheels came off in rather spectacular fashion, including, of course, their slump coinciding, really, with the announcement, surprise announcement, that Suzuki were withdrawing at the end of the season. Here's Alex Rins, the picture-perfect riding style from the silky smooth Spaniard. Although, as he said that, he gets it a little bit loose from that rear tyre. Coming through turn 17, Alex Rins over the line. No improvement from him. He stays third.
To be fair, Matt, Alex has been riding very well this year, exceptionally well. And I can't help but feel that Suzuki have lost out a little bit in the technology march forward.
Yeah. You have to think, don't you? Alex Rins, certainly over the last few races, since he got back to full fitness, having had his wrist broken in the Barcelona controversy, he's wringing every ounce of performance out of that factory Suzuki. Let's have a quick check on his teammate, Joan Mir. We knew it was going to be a painful return to action for Mir with the right ankle damage. Whoa, that was Marquez. Big, big moment for him, wasn't it? Coming through turn 17. And look what was happening as well. Before he had that scare, he was going to be where else? P1. Marquez stays in sixth place.
How that last turn works, Matt, is you fire it in, get out wide. You've still got to be on the throttle as you turn back to get the run out. Right in the middle on the edge grip, the rears let go.
Alex Espargaró thinks better of it. had he committed into the first corner there, he may well have just pushed the front a little bit too much. Picked that Aprilia up, didn't want to make it three crashes on day one. That would have been a disastrous start to his home Grand Prix for Aleix Espargaró. At the moment, he's down in 11th place, having had the spill this morning at turn 60 and then a crash at the start of this second free practice session at turn 14. Now then, this was Marc Márquez all in, as he so often is.
On the way in, pick up the throttle in the middle and let's go before you fire it out.
He's back. That's the kind of action that we miss, isn't it, from the eight times world champion. Had he not made that crucial mistake at that stage, he was on course to be potentially taking top spot away from Martin, who still leads with a 147.402. What can Bagnaia do? Look how far he's leaning off that factory Ducati. Elbows and knees down now, isn't it, through those final two corners. Breathtaking action from Bagnaia. Best he can hope for on day one, though, is fourth. He'll take that. Job done, a 147.639. What about Enea Bastianini then? He drops out of the reverse corkscrew. And as you'd expect, a good lap being put together here by the Italian. He's found his qualifying form of late, hasn't he? As the Italian on the 23 bike, pole position in Austria for the first time in MotoGP. He backed that up with the front row last time out in his home Grand Prix in Misano, on his way to a fifth consecutive podium finish in front of his home crowd in San Marino. What kind of time can he pick up in this fourth sector, where the Ducati, right from when we first came here back in 2010, has always had the upper hand, always had the advantage with its top speed and certainly its low gear acceleration out of turn 15. Just stay quiet again there, just so you could hear that seamless shift gearbox working beautifully in the hands of Enea Bastianini. At the moment, the beast is on course here for P1 on free practice Friday in Aragon. Over the crest he comes towards the finish line here. Bastianini then goes up into fourth, a 147.583. Just pushes Bagnaia then back to fifth place. It looks like, yeah, everybody's taking the checkered flag, bar this man, Jack Miller. He's not going to trouble Martin's 147.402. Big head shake there from Miller as he came out the final corner. He moves up into ninth.
Impressive job from local boy Jorge Martin. Then Fabio, I've got to say, wow, you know, forcing the Yamaha up in second. But I've got to say, to do that lap time, he can do it with nobody in front of him. Yeah, but the problem is doing that in a race when the V4s stop in the middle of the turn. He needs a clear track to be able to do those times. And then you jump down to Johann Zarco. What jumps out at me is he's done that on that new chassis, which he's, you know, which they've obviously taken from Misano test that he's trying. So
looks like Marc Márquez is, as you expect, a little bit ring rusty in terms of practice starts. That was a little bit scrappy.